They are always asking in the OSCE that why they asked about abdominal hysterectomy, because this is the most commonly performed gynae surgery for the benign conditions. The chance of having cancers is low, but the chance of having menorrhagia, fibroids is very high. Okay, that is the point. So first of all, if I give you a patient who is a candidate for abdominal hysterectomy, you will confirm her age and name and age. Okay, then you will say, I will take a focused, relevant history. What you need to ask here is that you will ask that has she been offered full range of the treatments, including the option of no treatment. So if she has tried all treatments, all strategies, and they have failed, or she declined to have tried those methods, then it's an indication for the abdominal hysterectomy. So you need to be sure that patient has got full information, okay? And then you need to take surgical consent from her. So you are going to stick to the guideline, like the consent guidelines we have done. And after that, you have to set up a meeting between an aesthetist and this patient, so they can find the best way forward, because your patient can have complications during anesthesia induction, or some maybe they are allergic to some drugs, maybe they are unfit for the OR. This is ASA, American Anesthetist Society's score, so patient has to be validated, assessed on that, okay? And if he has any shortcomings, then we have to fix it. Then, because they can have anesthetic complications, they can have surgical complications, okay? And then they can have, like, their risk may increase or decrease over a background of morbid conditions, comorbidities. So anyhow, patient has gone through these filters. Now you have decided that she is fit for OR. Patient also knows she is ready. Everything has been arranged. Still, during the pre-op round, you need to check some things. Don't forget to see go through that document, pre-operative checkups. You remember that pre-operative assessment. Okay, go through that. It's a short document. So you need to check the following items before surgery: complete blood counts, blood chemistry, urine analysis, electrocardiogram, chest X-ray examination, and pulmonary function test. Then cytology of this patient should be there, because you should know why exactly you are doing this procedure. It's a major procedure, right? She is having ataxia, she is having like simple hyperplasia, or she is having showing some signs of having some polyps, fibroids, endometriosis, adenomyosis. There is some mass, that is the point, okay? Or maybe there is nothing, but she has this idiopathic hemorrhagia, so you have decided to take the womb out. Ultrasound examination and the MRI to detect conditions such as uterine fibroids, adenomyosis, endometriosis. If endometrial cancer or the uterine sarcoma is suspected, contrast-enhanced MRI is performed. IV pyelography in patients where severe adhesions or retroperitoneal myomas are suspected. Tumor markers evaluation if endometrial carcinoma or uterine sarcoma is suspected. D-dimer evaluation, like with large uterine fibroids and malignant uterine tumors, the frequency of DVT increases. You should be sure what exactly your patient is having and what is her risk. And you are always going to check these things and modify your plan, okay? Because you need to tell them that you are a safe surgeon, okay? You can take the job independently. So what are the indications and contraindications? So the indications include uterine fibroids, uterine adenomyosis, cervical cancer up to stage 1A. After that, you will have to do other procedures also. Endometrial cancer, uterine sarcoma, ovarian cancer, choriocarcinoma of uterus, patient in whom postpartum massive bleeding doesn't stop, like she had placenta previa, ectonic bleeding, uterine rupture. These are the common indications. Can be 101, but these are the most common ones. Now, what are the contraindications? Cervical cancer, more than 1B stage, endometrial cancer, stage 2, and when total abdominal hysterectomy is contraindicated, then semi-radical hysterectomy or radical hysterectomy is performed in the endometrial cancer. So if they have the cancer, so you will say total abdominal hysterectomy is contraindicated, so we can do radical or semi-radical. As you know, now they have the if you have gone through the cancer of the uterus and cancer of the cervix, you must have seen that they have given different types of the hysterectomy. So don't go into that detail because your exam doesn't want you to go through all of these classifications and things. Just simple, crisp steps, because these are time limited, you know, time constraint is there, timed activity. So don't, if you will, like if you want to give a perfect picture, but you have passed that time, then nobody is ever going to give you any credit, okay? So don't go into the details. Pre-op preparation in the patients with huge, very large uterine fibroids, severe endometriosis, malignant disease, or adhesions, a large amount of bleeding is suspected. You have to anticipate the problems, okay? Therefore, autologous blood storage and preserved blood preparation is recommended. We can offer autologous blood transfusion. Storage, they mean that is the transfusion which we are doing during procedure. We can do the cell salvage where you are expecting the patient is going to lose like 1500 ml. In other patients such as those with like intraligamental myomas or the large cervical myomas, the risk of urethral injury, it will increase. Therefore, IV pyelography or inserting a urethral, that is in the ureter, stent is recommended. Pre-operative informed patient consents of knowledge of that above risk is required. If your patient has severe endometriosis, then the risk of having a ureteric injury is going to be 1 in 5. So it would be better that if we can send them to the radio where they can put like colored stents or they can just put some catheters so that we can dissect around those areas without causing any injury. Then you should remember that 2/3 of the injuries, urological injuries, they go unnoticed during procedure and only 1/3 they are diagnosed during procedure, and then only it is later that when the patient becomes symptomatic, then we come to know that this patient had some problem. So to summarize the steps, like the patient has, her ID has been confirmed, you will say, I will follow WHO checklist, okay, and right person, right place, right procedure, by the right person, at the right time, like that. Everything is right, okay, nothing is wrong. Patient will be checked in, and then after anesthesia, after taking permission from the anesthetist and in the presence of the consultant, or if the consultant has given you the permission, then you will proceed with the surgery. You will say that I will sterilize the abdomen, ask my team that everything is ready and the cautery has been plugged in and things are fine, everything is available, and then I will start the procedure. We will scrub the skin with the antiseptic solution and then I will give the first incision. So I will open the abdomen into layers and then I will inspect all areas. How is the full abdomen? That is the first step. Okay, you are going to inspect the interior of the abdomen, the status of the viscera. Is there any fluid? Is there any blood? And is there any sign of inflammation? Then you have to see the under surfaces of the diaphragm and the liver also, like that. So you are going to inspect the whole visual field. So you will say that I will identify the uterus and I will see if there is any fluid, if there are any adhesions. Then I will apply the first clamp on the round ligament. I will ligate, I will clamp, ligate and cut the round ligament. So you have ligated, so then clamp, cut and ligate the ovarian ligament and the fallopian tube or the infundibulopelvic ligament. Okay, so these ligaments, ovarian, first round, then ovarian, okay, and the fallopian tube is also cut, or you can say that I'm going to ligate and cut the infundibulopelvic ligament. If you are planning to take the uterus, the ovaries out, then you will apply medial to the ovaries. Otherwise, you will go distally and you will take the ovaries also in the same pedicle. Then you will go down and mobilize the bladder. It is better to mobilize the bladder down by sharp dissection, because with the blunt dissection, the chances of injuring the bladder, they will increase. After that, I will clamp, cut and ligate the uterine artery and vein on both sides. Then I will push down the stump with gauze. Okay, now we have like the stump is there. You have removed these ligaments, so it is lying like almost freely. So you need to take out the lower part. You will clamp, cut, and ligate the sacrouterine ligament and the posterior half of the cardinal ligament. After that, you will clamp, cut, and ligate the zygouterine ligament and the anterior half of the cardinal ligament. After that, you will say, I will clamp the boundary between the posterior vaginalis and the vagina. Then you will incise the vagina and remove the uterus. So you are cutting and opening the vagina. You are taking this one cervix out, holding the this wall of the vagina, and then you will suture it. So what you will do, you will disinfect the vagina and close the vaginal cuff or the wall like that. Okay. After that, you will see, you will inspect all pedicles for hemostasis, that there is no blood, there is no collection, things are fine, bladder is intact, and then you will close the peritoneum, and then you will close the, you will not close the peritoneum, close the retroperitoneum, like in the lower, the pouch of Douglas, it has been closed, everything is fine, there is no collection, inspect again all the vistas, ask the nurse that are the counts complete, everything, nothing is left behind, swabs are okay, and then you are going to close the abdominal wall, like you will close the rectus sheath with the vitral one, and then if there is abdominal fat is there, so you will close the abdominal muscles if you need to, otherwise just leave it, and then close the, you have closed the abdomen in reverse. If there are more than 2.5 centimeter of the subcutaneous fat, then you are going to suture the fats also, interrupted sutures better, and then subcuticular to the skin. So here you didn't ask me that what type of incision we are going to give. So it depends on the indication of the hysterectomy. If you are doing it for menorrhagia and the uterine size is like less than 12 weeks, then you are going to give horizontal incision, okay? So you can give Joel Cohen, you can give Fenestrin, depending upon your convenience. If you think that the size of the uterus is, like your assessment says that the size of the uterus is more than 12 weeks, then you are going to give longitudinal incision in from the umbilical, and you can always extend it around the umbilicus, and then you can do the needful, and then you can close it. After closing, we need to clean the vagina and insert catheter is already there, so you are going to come out like that. So that is the basic detail of the basic steps of the procedure, and I want you guys to stop here. Okay, if you want to know about the further things, then we can go over them. Like I will show you just pictures here, son. Like when you have entered the abdomen, what you are going to see is the urinary bladder, right? Here you know that this is the cervix, okay? These are the cardinal ligaments, okay? And these are the sacrouterine ligaments. And this is from where our uterosacral ligaments, and these are the ureters. Okay, so they are running in your field. So you can see that they are passing under the zygouterine ligament like that. What are these ligaments? These are just thickening of the local fascia, pelvic fascia like that. Okay, sacrouterine ligaments and zygouterine ligaments, and these are the cardinal ligaments. So these two ligaments, uterosacral, cardinal, they are going to support the lower part of the this uterus and the cervix. They are attached to these things like that. So do you feel like reading the details or what? Because no one is ever going to ask you the detail like that, okay? So first step, you just held the round ligament, and then we can cut it, or we can simply like cauterize it to separate them like that, okay? And say here should be like double knot, square knot, double knot, and then just leave it there, okay? That is how you are holding. So this is on the broad ligament. Mind you, we are cutting the round ligament. We are not cutting the broad ligament. That is one thing, okay? So then look at that. There are like many faults and many problems, but don't go into the details. You are removing the infundibular below pelvic ligament, okay? First we remove your round ligament, then we took out infundibular pelvic. If you want to remove the ovaries with them, then you will not apply here. You will go at some distance to improve the ovaries, and then after the ovaries, you are going to put clamp and remove it like that, okay? After that, you are going to push the bladder down, like you are mobilizing the bladder like down. It should go down, otherwise, you know, it can be damaged during the procedure like that. So some of the experts, they can do it with the help of like cautery, or the new people, they can do it like by a sharp dissection with scissors. And after this procedure, what you need to do is, like it, you are going to ligate the arteries. Be very careful because the ureter is lying just 1.5 centimeter behind the uterine artery. Arteries here, like a bridge, and the ureter is here. That is the point. Okay. Be very careful because the uterine artery is also running into the broad ligament, and the ureter is passing under that. Ureter is just like 1.5 centimeter above the lateral fornix of the uterus. That is one thing. Okay. So you have done this process, then what exactly are you going to do? You can see here that all ligaments, they have been cut. Okay, so you are going to open the vaginal peritoneum, the vault. Okay, because we need to take the things out. You can use like different instruments. Every detail is here, but they are not going to ask you in the OSCE that what are you going to do like that. Okay, so we are opening the vault so that we can remove the uterus like that. That is the point. So after doing it, what happens, you are going to put large clamps on both sides, like Haynes can be applied, and then you know you are, and these are the retention sutures, okay, so that you can identify that where is the vault. And then we are cutting the stump. If you have to leave the cervix behind, then you can leave it behind, and you are going to cut here. But if you are doing total abdominal hysterectomy, and we started with total abdominal hysterectomy, okay, so we will go here down, and we are going to cut it. Rest of the stumps, they have already been cut, the pedicles. Okay, so this is, you can see the cervix, it has been opened. First we separated everything, then we have cut. This is the cervix, there is the uterus, so you know there is some angulation like that. So take that out, then you will be left with something like this. Okay, so just close it in two layers. And after that, what are you going to do? Like there is bladder, so you can again use like 3-0, and you are using absorbable sutures all the time like that. Okay, so it has been removed. Things, and this is the ureter. Just ensure before you go out that the things are fine. We have not damaged the bladder. We have not damaged the ureter. How you will identify the ureter? Ureter has pulsations. It is whitish in color, and it has pulsations. And the blood vessels, they will not have peristaltic movement, and they will not be so thick. So ureter is thicker, and it has like peristaltic movements are there. So you can identify it, and then by its location. So things have gone out, nothing to worry about. Take the uterus out, and then just close the abdomen in reverse. You don't have to do a lot to your leg. Part of the question is that, so those were the steps of the abdominal hysterectomy. Now you did hysterectomy on someone, and after 6 days after the procedure, this is the question. Okay, so lady, 6 days post total abdominal hysterectomy with constant watery PV discharge, what is the differential diagnosis, investigations, and management? Okay, so if there is continuous watery discharge, what comes to your mind like that? So differential diagnosis for this presentation could be urinary fistula, urinary tract infection, wound infection, and then peritoneal fluid drainage through the vaginal vault. That is first thing. Okay, how do we investigate the patient? That is the second part. So patient assessment, it should start by taking a history that explores the onset of the discharge, when it started. Timing is very important. Whether the discharge smells, particularly whether it smells like urine or not, whether the woman has frequency of and burning menstruation or not, whether she had any fever or felt unwell, whether there is any pain and or swelling in the area, and whether she has given any antibiotics, she was given any antibiotics by her doctor, and if so, what was the impact of taking them, and has she been taking them regularly. Then assessment then moves to examination, which should include establishing temperature and pulse, inspection of the discharge on a pad as well as the wound, using a speculum, and performing a digital vaginal examination to establish whether there is a collection or not. Speculum and digital examination, they can be painful in the presence of infection as well as recent wounds and both. There is a wound and there is inspection. So it should be performed gently or avoided by inexperienced staff. The choice of special investigations should be customized to the patient features. The investigations that can help reaching the diagnosis, they include urine dipstick, midstream urine culture and sensitivity, high vaginal swab for culture and sensitivity, pelvic ultrasound scan, 3-gauze methylene blue test, possibly with endocarbine test to check both. So we can give methylene blue and like endocarbine we are giving, or you can also use pyrazinamide. Like you can give the tab to the patient, this indicocarbine, it will give the urine a green color, okay, and the methylene blue will give a blue color. So this one is going to the bladder and this one is going to the system. So if you get a green spot or if the patient has taken pyrazinamide tab, it will give the urine an orange color, okay. So if there is high fistula like between the ureter and the vagina, then you are going to get a green spot on the swab, or you are going to get an orange swab. So instead of using the swabs, you can use it tampons also, because they are lengthy. So you are going to, you can identify the spot where the fistula is by the location of the stain. So cystography or the IV urography, again to check for the bladder as well as the ureteric fistula, and then we can do the cystoscopy. So now you have identified that where is the fistula, so you now need to fix it. So first of all, good counseling of the patient is very important. Why? Because you know it can be like very much scaring for the patient. Patient can go into PTSD. Patient can have so many other problems. So good counseling and communication skills are very important. MDT, like the multidisciplinary team, should manage it, and management will depend upon the cause. If there is infection, it should be treated with antibiotics, and the woman who is losing peritoneal fluid through the vagina, they should be reassured that this would settle with time. And pelvic collection, it may need drainage, but is usually managed conservatively as at this stage after surgery. Vesicovaginal fistula is managed by bladder drainage for 3 months. You will consult the patient that we can put the catheter and allow the free drainage, and if there is a small defect like less than 2 centimeter, it may heal spontaneously, okay. And initially you will need to give antibiotics to the patients like for 5, 7 or 10 days depending upon her circumstances, but you don't have to offer antibiotics for whole 12 weeks. So a uretrovaginal fistula, it may need a ureteric stent or surgical repair with or without re-anastomosis, re-implantation as appropriate. And with patient counseling is important here, and breaking bad news and risk management and good note documentation, they will all be relevant. So address all of these issues with the patient, and if she has any questions, answer them. Put her in contact with a support group and give her contact number of a person who she can contact anytime if she has any question. Okay, so opening the station as well as closing the station is very important. Okay, so you can summarize also that in short, this patient has suffered this surgical problem. She has developed a fistula, could be due to different causes, could be due to infection, could be due to direct injury, or could be due to secondary to the diathermal injury. But the diathermal injuries, usually they become evident after 14 days, but maybe this patient had infection. We don't know that she was having any comorbidities or what. So I will summarize the process for her, that what is the way forward. I will include her in decision making. So if she will have any questions, we will answer them. If she wants to complain, I will counsel her about the complaint procedure. So that's all you need to do here. Any questions, any problems?